So if they told me that he was batting a .325, then that's like a 32.5%. So I would do 100, not that. I would do 100 minus 32.5. So the other percentage would be 67.5. So the other answer would be 0.675.
Wow. I just did one minus.
You can do the same thing.
It works no matter when.
It'll always work. Y'all scared. Okay. we opened up the... We have whiny babies in here, boo-boo. Whiny babies. Did you know that? We have whiny babies in here. They want the test to be open until Thursday. And we had already opened the homework until next Sunday. We're going to run out of days. They're just going to keep pushing it back and back. So you have until Thursday, this Thursday at closing, to take the test. And you have until Sunday to finish up the homework. Only one person's taking it.
Okay. I'm not a superhero.
Excuse me, one more. There was one about the children, like three boys. And
having three girls, three kids, three youngins. Mm-hmm. You might know what the three youngin' problem was?
Is that at the end?
At the end?
It's one of them, but it's like the same thing at the end.
Okay.
And I guess I'm gonna be glad I don't wanna do that.
Alright, three youngins. I don't, let me see. Three youngins. Let me go backwards.
I love it. I remember what she said, probably all. I just thought that they did too.
You got to have a pattern when you know those youngins. Method to the madness. My husband was, we went to the beach for the weekend, and it's the first time we've been out of town in all of 2017, which is crazy for us. Since we started our business, we hadn't gone anywhere. And so we shopped all weekend long. We didn't get to the beach till 3:30 Sunday morning. I mean, Saturday morning, because we had a Ducks Unlimited banquet. And so all day Saturday we shopped, all day Sunday we shopped. And my husband told everybody, I'm here to pay and to carry the bags and to pay. That's it. That's the only reason she brings. And for his military benefits. Because it was Veterans Weekend, so he just shows his card. He said, I'll sit outside until you need me to show my card. And then I just carry the bags. I drive and I pay. There he is.
You got your money.
All right. So, into the current page. We are having three kids, so it's a kid times a kid times a kid. So that means 2 times 2 times 2. 2 times 2 is 4. 4 times 2 is 8. So that means we're going to have 8 different listings. So what I do is I do girl, girl, girl. Then I throw in a boy. A boy first, a boy second, a boy third. So a boy and 2 girls, a boy in the middle, and a boy at the back. Then I throw in 2 boys. 2 boys in the front, 2 boys in the back, and split the boys up. And then I throw in all boys. That gives me my 8 options. So I have no boys, I have 1 boy, I have 2 boys, and then I have all boys. And the question says, what is the probability that he has at least 1 boy? So all of these are going to make him happy. This is the only one that he's going to be mad about. So it's going to be 7/8. So 7/8 is going to give 0.875. So my answer to this one is going to be B. Now what if I said, what's the probability that he has exactly 2 boys? What's the probability that he has exactly 2 boys? 3/8. Cool? All right. So, talk about, pick up where we left off in chapter 5. We did, I don't know what we did, we did something last time. We talked about the 68-95-99-7 rule.
Mm-hmm.
That 68% of the data was within one deviation, 95% of the data was in two deviations, and 99.7% of the data was in three deviations. Now, everything that we did last time was a pretty jump. Okay? So everything that we did last time was either exactly one jump, exactly half a jump, you know, one jump to the right, one jump to the left, or one jump in either direction, two jumps in either direction, two jumps in one direction. So we did one jumpers or two jumpers or three jumpers in either direction. Well, in real life, things aren't going to be exactly a full jump. Okay? So I have a problem here where my mean is 100, my standard deviation is 20. So I did a mean of 100 and then I did 20s in my jumpage. But what if I said that my data point was 114? So do you agree that from 100 to 120 is a whole jump? So 114 is not a full jump. You with me? So what we do is we do the z-score. And on your formula sheet, we have a formula called the z-score. And let me pull your formula sheet up for just a second. On our formula sheet, and you will be allowed to use your formula sheet on the final exam. Let me get formula sheet. Your formula sheet says right here that your z-score, which is also known as standard score, is your data minus your mean over your standard deviation. So I'm going to cover that up because it means more than what that does. So this is on your formula sheet. Your z-score, which is also how many jumps you are, is your data value minus your mean over your standard deviation. So to figure out how many jumps this is, I take my data, which is 114, minus my mean, which is 100, divided by my standard deviation, which is 20. So 0.7 tells me that that point is 0.7 jumps away from my mean. We cool? If your jump is positive, that means you're jumping to the right. If your z-score is negative, that means you're jumping to the left. If your z-score is zero, that means you didn't jump. Okay? So, let me come down here. I did several examples in one. For this problem, I have a normal distribution with a mean of 80, a standard deviation of 10. So I did 80 plus 10 plus 10 plus 10, 80 minus 10 minus 10 minus 10. So it's 80, 90, 100, 110, and 80, 70, 60, 50. We good? And I have four different points that I have data. I have 90, which is a star. I have 95, which is a yellow dot. I have 80, which is a blue dot. And then I have 64, which I did in purple. So some of these, we don't even have to use the z-score. For example, look at the star. How many jumps is my star away from my mean? One jump. I don't need to do the z-score formula, because I can tell it's a pretty jump. But if I wanted to do the formula, it says data minus mean over standard deviation. My data is my point. My point is 90. My mean is 80. My standard deviation is 10. 90 minus 80 is 10. 10 divided by 10 is 1. It was a pretty jump. I really didn't need to do the formula. It's positive because I'm going to the right. 95. 95 is how far between 90 and 100? So what should we think that our z-score should be?
95.
So how many jumps is it?
One and a half.
Okay? But if I do my formula, my data is what?
95 minus 80 divided by 10.
So 95 minus 80 is 15. 15 divided by 10 is 1.5. And it's positive because we're going that way. If my data is 80, how many jumps is 80 from my mean?
None.
80 minus 80 is 0. 0 divided by 10 is nothing. It's just like when I tell y'all after a test, the class average was 85. What are you doing in your head? You're saying, I made a 92, I made this many points above. Or I made a 75, I made this many points below. This is what you're doing. You're figuring out how far are you from the class average. Are you above the class average? Are you below the class average? Or did you make the class average? If you made the class average, then your z-score is going to be 0. You didn't deviate from the class average. Here, 64. You made below the class average. So your z-score is going to be negative. Your negative jumps. You're below. So it's not a pretty jump. It's not halfway. So my data is 64. Minus my mean is 80 and my standard deviation is 10. 64 minus 80 divided by 10 is negative 1.6. So my point is 1.6 jumps to the left because it's negative. Y'all with me? Now this one is just showing you generically. Consider I have a normal curve. Normal distribution with the points A, B, and C. One of those points is the mean. Well, do you agree the mean is going to be the one in the middle? One point corresponds to the mean plus one standard deviation. One point corresponds to the mean minus two standard deviations. Well, if we're adding a standard deviation, if we're subtracting deviations, so it just makes you realize that the mean's always in the middle, and if you're adding, you're going this way, and if you're subtracting, you're going this way. Okay, on your formula sheet, and I'm not going to spend too long on this because we're going to be able to do everything in our calculator. But on your formula sheet, Okay, we've only been dealing with like the first page of the formula sheet, but the back three pages of the formula sheet is how I used to do z-scores back in the day. We had to look up these tables. I gave you three pages of tables. Ugh. Your calculator will do all this for you. Now, I'm just going to show you one problem so that you can appreciate the table, okay? One is called table 5.1, and the other two are called table 5. So we have a table 5 and a table 5.1. Table 5.1 is what I call the easy table. I'm going to pull this over just so that I can show you quickly. Let me get my little snagging thing. Come on, Snagger. I'm going to get my little snagging machine. I'm going to pull it over to a new piece of paper. Okay, this is what I call the easy table. And the only reason that it's called the easy table is because everything is on one table. Now, standard score is another name for z-score. So we have the negative z-scores in this column, and we have the positive z-scores in this column. So, let me grab a problem. Let's see, I'm just going to do, let me give an easy problem. Let's do. Okay, in our last class, we did the 68-95-99-7 rule. The 68-95-99-7 rule is an approximation. It's just like rounding. So when you're doing your homework, if the homework says use the 68-95-99-7 rule, then you're going to approximate. When you're doing these, it's going to say use table 5. Or is it 5.2? This one's 5.1. It's going to say use table 5.1. We're still going to do the same thing. We're still going to draw what it tells us to draw. And it's still going to have, like this says less than 132. So we're still going to do this. The only difference here, and I'm going to show you how to do it in the calculator, which is so much stinking easier, but I just want you to understand the table. First thing we have to do is we have to find the z-score. So the z-score corresponds to my data point, which is my ending point. So what is the z-score for this point? Is it a pretty z-score?
Yes.
Yes. What is my z-score? How many jumps is this point from my mean?
Two.
Positive two. You with me? I took two jumps in the right direction, so my z-score is positive two. So I go up to here. Standard score is the same thing as your z-score. These two columns are negative. These two columns are positive. My z-score is a positive 2. 97.72%. So because my z-score is positive 2, my percent is 97.72. A z-score of 2 gives me 97.72%. Now, the only thing that you have to remember is that the table only gives percents to the left. So the table is only going to give you to the left, to the left, to the left, like Beyonce. So if I give you a problem, number 18, if I give you a problem that says percent of 84 or larger. Percent of 84 or larger. First thing we got to do is find our z-score. What is our z-score going to be for 84? Our z-score is the number of jumps.
One.
It's to the left. So what's our z-score is to the left?
Negative.
So my z-score is going to be a negative 1. Because I went one jump in the negative direction. So I go up here. Let me do it in a different color. My z-score for this one is a negative 1. So I come up here and I find my z-score of negative 1. And it corresponds with 15.87. Well, 15.87 is the shading to the left. The table only gives the shading to the left of that point. I want to know the shading to the right. So how would I find the shading to the right?
You subtract 100%.
You subtract it from 100%, because if the whole thing's 100%, so if this whole graph is 100%, and they gave me that portion, and I want to know this portion, I'm going to do 100% minus the 15.87. So I'm going to do 100% minus the 15.87. So my answer is going to be 84.13. The table just gives you to the left. And you got to have the z-score to use the table. So that's the first table. Now, the second table, I call the hard table, where everything puts this table on one sheet of paper. And it goes 3.53292827. This one has a whole page of negative z-scores. This one has a whole page of positive z-scores. So instead of doing two columns of positives, it does a whole page of negatives and a whole page of positives. So I'm not going
to
do
that to us when we take the test.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Hold on. Let me. And I'm just gonna do one of these just to show you. Now at the top, this is called table five. But just to show you, at the top of the table, at the top of the table, it gives you this little picture to remind you that it's only going to tell me the area to the left. So when you get these percentages, it's only the area to the left. So if I give you an example that says, I'm just making up some numbers. If I give you 100, 110, 120, 90, 80, blah, blah, blah. What if I did this? We first have to know the z-score. What is the z-score for that problem?
2, negative.
Crap. Let me keep going because I didn't put my negatives over here. Let me do that one, whatever that is. That's going to be a positive 2. Y'all with me?
Mm-hmm.
I put the positives over here, so I need to go to the positives. So, I'm going to use that. My z-score is a positive 2.00. So, I would do 2.000. Now, on the other chart, it told me 97.7. This one, you got the whoop-whoop. This one's going to be a 97.72. That's the only difference. This one's going to be 97.72%. Now, it's to the left. Did we go to the left? Yeah, so that's it. We cool? Now, the good thing about this one is what if your z-score... Example, what if my z-score was 1.23? I would come over here and I would do the 1.2 there. Then I would get my 3 from there. And I would come over and that would be my percentage. 89.07. So I can get more specific on this chart than I can on the other chart. If my z-score was 1.23 and I was using this chart, I can't do 1.23. If my z-score was 1.23 on this chart, I would either have to use 1.2 or 1.3. I would use 1.2 because it rounds down. But on this chart, I can get more specific. You with me?
What you mean it rounds down?
1.23 is closer to 1.2 than it is to 1.3. But on this chart, I can go to 1.23. We cool? Now, let me show you how to use the calculator. Because the calculator is the best. This shows, I mean, if you want to read how to do the table, this shows you. I've done tons of problems on how to use the calculator. But calculator, 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 calculator. Let's figure out one where. Now let's use the calculator. Okay. So let's pull out our calculators. Okay, so for this problem, when we started this problem, it wanted to know, we want to know the percentage of scores less than 116. And the problem said that we had a normal distribution with a mean of 100, a standard deviation of 16, and our point is 116. Okay? So, we have a normal distribution. a mean of 100, a standard deviation of 16, and our point is 116. Now, even if the directions said, use a table, we ain't got to use a table. We can use our calculator. You have a button on your calculator that is called normal CDF. It is located when you type second VARS. It is the normal CDF. It's the second one down, normal CDF. Second VARS, normal CDF. Yeah.
We do this, is it going to mess up the other
nothing,
thing?
It won't mess up anything that we did in chapter 6 or 7.
Okay. So you said do what now?
Second VARS, normal CDF. Now, according to when your calculator was made, on the outside it doesn't matter, but on the inside it does. My calculator is going to ask me certain things. Your calculator may go back to the home screen and it may just say normal CDF parentheses. Okay? Now, if your calculator says normal CDF parentheses, you're going to do the same thing I'm going to do. You're just going to type them in and put comps. Okay? So, no matter how it looks, we're doing the same thing. So if yours says normal CDF comma, the first thing you have to put in is the lower limit. Let me show you. 116 and 116. Now, and we're shading this. Your lower limit is the number that you shade on the left. So if I'm shading the lowest number that, do you agree I'm shading forever this way?
Mm-hmm.
Technically, if I shaded, I would shade forever this way. So the number that we put, if we're shading forever in that direction, is going to be negative 999. Mm-hmm. If I shade forever in that direction, I put -999. I promise I'm going to do more than one. Your upper limit is the number that you shade the furthest on the right. So when I'm shading, where do I stop shading? So my upper limit is going to be 116. You are correct. My mean, what is my mean in this problem?
100.
My mean is going to be 100, and what is my standard deviation?
16.
So in my calculator, it asks for them individually. So in my calculator, my lower limit is going to be -999. My upper limit is going to be 116. My mean, which is the cursive U, is 100. And my standard deviation is 16. If yours doesn't look like mine, you're going to, so here's the two different ways it's going to look. And let me hit enter. So some calculators, you type it in like this. Other calculators, you type it in like that.
What is the comma?
Your comma is above the 7. So your lower limit is what's shaded on the left. Lower limit is your left. Your upper limit is the right. Your mean is in the middle. Your standard deviation is your jumps. And then you got to whoop the answer. Now, the good thing with your calculator is if you tell it what's the lower limit and what's the upper limit, it's not like the table. The table's always to the left. As long as you tell it the lower and the upper limit, it's going to tell you the right percentage every time. Let's do another one. All right, let's try this one. Percentages of scores greater than 108. So my mean is 100, my standard deviation is 16, my data is 108. So what would my lower limit be? What's the thing that I shaded on the left? What's the first thing I shaded on the left? What's the first thing that I shaded on the left?
When I start shading, where did I start shading on the left?
108.
108 is where I start shading. Where do I stop shading on the right? Positive 999. What's my mean? What's my standard deviation?
16.
So for this one, my low